Hello everybody, welcome to episode 70 of the Contest Round podcast. If you don't know already, we're available on YouTube, SoundCloud, Spotify and iTunes. And as well, another week brings, well, fresh stuff to the game. Kind of, a little bit scuffed, of course it is. And we've got all that to dissect, as well as What If episode 2, which is really exciting. As always, I'm joined by my co-host Dan of Frontline MCOC. You can catch him at www.frontlinemcoc.home.blog for all your information about what's going on in the community. Make sure to make it your homepage, and as well on Twitter with the handle at frontlinemcoc. Dan, another week, a little bit of scuff.
They issued that hotfix, and it's been very mixed reactions. You know, I have certainly had some issues with pairing this week, yeah. But it's in sporadic bursts, right? It's like It'll be fine for an hour, and then like one fight will just everything completely falls apart for me.
Yeah,
and I don't know if that's me adjusting to timing. I don't know if it's the game, but there have been this few fights where I'm like, wow, that just happened.
Yeah, I've had that as well. I think that's one of the things of going, right, we've got this summoner showdowns now in with a very shorter time frame of grind.
Right. Compressed, yes.
Yeah. And look, you know, that's just the thing. I know Kabam probably want to get that off their plate as soon as possible because it then derails. Maybe they've got schedules to keep with what they're meant to be running in conjunction with a virtual New York Comic Con. I don't know, just theorizing. So then maybe they got a tight window with Marvel Entertainment of running something on theirs. But yeah, it's certainly been a week. I've got my second vaccine this week, and I tell you what, I had this sore throat at the start of the week, and I've just had to take my hoodie off, and I'm already just like, it's really cold in the UK, and I'm now kind of like I'm roasting up as we record this on a Friday. I've never been so hot on what is a cold day. It's kind of weird. So I'm going to have to take it easy over this weekend, which we are recording on Friday.
Hang in there. You should be feeling better in a day or two.
Yeah. That's what I'm hoping for. I mean,
is your arm sore?
Oh, that's gone down now. I had that like on day one, but that's kind of like,
okay.
That's gone down. I am pretty sore in any case because I did. Do you have it in the US, airsoft? Would you refer to it? Do you know what airsoft is?
No, what's airsoft?
Airsoft is, now if you're watching on YouTube, I will kind of show you this. It's referred to as like a BB gun. I mean, you have actual guns.
Oh, okay. All right.
Sort of plastic ball bearings.
No, I know what you're talking about now.
Yeah.
Yep.
I got shot by a lot of those. There's this one thing, because I had my stag weekend last weekend. It was a case, what we do is, they say, right, we're going to play a game called Hunt the Stag. So the stag has to... we have to kind of...
It's your special day. We're going to shoot you.
Yeah, exactly. And it's really weird. You go around an old court, like an old like English court, where it's kind of like, you know, sentence that person to death. It was at Bristol in the UK. And you had to go... They said, right, okay, hunt the stag. You have to run down the corridor, down to the jail cells, run along the jail cells, come up the stairs to where into the dock. So obviously when they send them off to kind of like be sentenced, they go down into the cells. I had to do a circuit of that. But the thing is, I did it with other stags, and there's about 20 non-stags there. And some person, another stag, who we got really shirty at because he wouldn't give up. Anyway, that's another bite about. He grabbed me. And used me as a meat shield.
The stags turned on each other during the hunt, and you were used as a human shield.
Yeah, he used me as a human shield, and when we got up,
Rich,
we got up from the cells to the dock, and as soon as I got up, I just went, oh shit! All of them, they were in the galleries of the court, in the jury box. They were up where the judge sits. And they were all aiming. Matey boy behind me was crouched behind me, grabbing my I think my legs. And they just went, du-du-du-du-du-du-du-du-du. And I had about, I think, between 20 and 30, like, little dots on my back from it.
Oh, my God.
And so when I got to the safe space, I just kind of, you know, you do that thing where you just go, and you just, like, let out that frustration of, like, constant stings of pain. It was like that. Anyway, sorry, Dan, I've derailed.
Well, I think Americans are getting a bad rap. I mean, I didn't get hunted during my bachelor party. We just sat on a boat and drank.
That sounds nice.
It was very relaxing.
I did have a nice time though, because we went to a few kind of like cocktail bars and stuff. There's one, we went past this one place, and this woman said, "Hey, come in, lads, come and have a drink." And I said, "Sorry, we can't stop. We're late for a concert." And the lady went, "Oh, you've got a girlfriend? All right." And I went, "I didn't say that. I just said we got a concert to go to. We're late to." It was actually a nice time. We went to a few cocktail bars. One place called Her Majesty's Secret Service, which is an old speakeasy. We were kind of sold that it was a James Bond speakeasy. So you knock on the door, you give a code, and you're able to come in. But it was like Prohibition times. But it wasn't that. It was like it just wasn't what we imagined. And my friend was like, "Oh, the images kind of like sold it more than it was, but hey, it is what it is." Hey, sorry, Dan, we better get back to talking about Marvel Contest and Champions.
I think everyone is invested in the saga of your pending nuptials, so yeah. I like the updates, Rick. I'm all for it. But yeah, let's get into it with MCOC. I had one of my most reacted to tweets ever this week. I just wish it had gone a little better for me. And you know, I appreciate everyone's thoughts and prayers on the results of my Summer of Pain Nexus, which was classic Spider-Man, Rhino, and Hulk. And to the people who think theirs was just as bad, it wasn't. Rogue is better than any of those three. Psylocke is better than any of those three.
Yeah.
Panda Man Pete, though, he had a pretty bad one.
Oh,
he might have been the only other person I saw. His was Airwalker, Super Skrull, Heimdall, and it was a Heimdall Awakening.
I just got that on there. So
Panda Man Pete, you are my peer in the. In the six star Nexus, bad luck, because that was brutal, bud.
Yeah, I may have felt for you. I saw yours and I thought,
yep.
I mean, I was happy with mine. It was just one of these situations where I've been hunting for Professor X and Omega Red, and I get. I was like, yeah, okay, I've awakened Colossus. Thumbs up. I could have done Mr. Sinister if I wanted, and I have got a game plan for that, but I'm investing into my 5-star version first, because I'm not going to I'm not going to invest in all my mutant signature stones, 6-star signature stones, into Mr. Sinister just yet. I prefer, because it's easier for me to obtain the 5-star signature stones, I prefer to 200 signature my Mr. Sinister to invest into that, because I just can't stand reverse controls, and I want a champion that's able to deal with it, and also I like high signature version of him. But that's another story for another day and another video. But some people are, mixed results. Yes, mixed results.
Yeah, exactly. I saw a lot of people get Dr. Doom, though.
Yes.
A lot of people got the Dr. Doom, went Mystic.
Saw
a few Apocalypses. I think a lot of people went Mutant yesterday, based on the screenshots.
Yeah. There was
I can't blame them for that.
There's a lot of solid options that you get with the mutant line. I would have loved to get Strife, but I just recently picked him up as a 5-star, so I guess I can't complain there. But it's all good. It's all good.
Yeah, but overall, pretty good rewards. But we're on to the final challenge now.
This one was there were some things that were kind of like rumored. I'm glad that it's better than it was, because that's the other thing, like the way that it was sort of rumors were flying around and how the rewards were. It didn't take into consideration that there could be something like a solo event that came in as a kind of like a side piece to this, which is good, because a lot of the time you'll kind of do it and go, right, well, one time round, many time round, you're like, well, I don't know. But then it's like, it's better than it is, which is nice. I'm still kind of debating my team of going in. I will give it a go, but then if I just kind of go like, oh, I don't know, this is not for me. I mean, the good thing about it, I think, is the Grandmaster's a little bit less on the health. Is that correct?
I don't know because I haven't fought him yet. But the Grandmaster part is the part that worries me the most.
That is as well. I kind of
because I haven't fought this guy in a long time. I have to rewatch some videos and get used to his phases again. Because I'm pretty confident I can get through all of those fights in one or two revives to get to him.
Yeah.
But okay, you know. But then it's like, all right, you know, reverse controls.
Yeah,
all his phases. Like I went in and fought him the first time, I used Mr. Sinister to get around the reverse controls, and I was still having quite a few issues with that fight until I really got the hang of it. So I know I'm going to be rusty the first couple times. You know, the other issue is, of course, am I going to try to clear all this with six different classes to get all the objectives? Can I do that in six runs, or is it going to be cheaper to do more runs and do the extra classes on an easy path and just, I think there's different ways to approach it, right? Like, do you just look at the lanes in a vacuum and say, all right, who's my best for this lane and clear the lane? Or do you really try to say, all right, well, I got to take it a B option because I already use science and I don't want to use an extra run or something like that. You know, I think there's different strategies there. I would say, like, look at the hard, I think I would say look at the hardest paths and was like, all right, well, I clearly need to use Immortal Abomination for that Mysterio, right? So that's my science. So, like, you know, I think start there. Like, I think there's a couple lanes, like Emma and Ghost in particular, where anybody could do that lane, provided you know how to dodge Emma's reverse controls.
That's really it. Yeah, I just need to think if I could be bothered to do it. That's the thing for me. Like, as soon as I've cleared the monthly content, then I'll kind of like go back in and go, am I interested? Is this, you know, becoming too frustrating? Am I in the mood? Is it something I need to grind out? Because that's another thing as well. Just going like, do I need to do it? Like, will the amount of tier six basic and tier three alpha be that thing that interests me? Is there much point? Am I going to make a rank 4 6-star by, I don't know, Cyber Weekend this year? Am I not? Is it going to be, can I guess what's going to be in those deals? Those kind of things. Do I invest units? Do I not? There's a lot of variables to consider with that. Will it be similar to July 4th deals if I invest my units this way or that way? So I don't know. It's just going to be one of these situations of going, is it worth my time, my effort, and my grind? But still got time.
Yeah,
still got time.
I think there's just such a big cutoff in rewards. Like, I think you really want to do at least one run.
Yeah.
Because you get those completion rewards, and then if you get to tier 4 of the milestones, you know, that's when you start to get the T3 alpha.
Yeah.
And you know, I don't think it makes sense to do like two runs or three runs. Like, I think you could do one. You could do 4, or you got to go for 100% of everything.
Yeah.
So you kind of got to decide, like, what's your pain point? Because there's definitely some cutoffs there with the rewards.
Yeah. And I think that's a better point to go, like, okay, well, what is, as you said, what is my pain point? And going, like, look, if I can pick up at least Milestone 4, then, yeah, it's like you get a good chunk of everything. You get a little bit for your trouble. And yeah, with the completion as well. Yeah, I think it's a good point. I might kind of do that, kind of consider like what points I can grab from various places. Is 2 runs enough? Is one run? Yeah, 2 runs enough for me. Like, I can't take this no more. Kind of thing. Yeah, absolutely. I'm glad that they did add something extra, because I think this is something that adds in for players to grind, especially over the summer period. Especially because next month.
Oh yeah.
I don't know, is next month Act 7.3? Was it the month after?
I mean, they haven't issued anything yet as far as notes. So we don't know yet. I mean, we know Act 7.3 is coming, so I mean, it could be next month, it could be October, we don't know. Hopefully, you know, next episode we'll know, though.
Yeah, that's true.
So because it's coming out, you know, next Friday should be the big news dump. Because then we'll be going into the first week of September with the new event quest going live. And, you know, fingers crossed. I know we don't talk about rumors much, but
no,
September is usually X-Men month. And for X-Men fans, there's been some exciting rumors.
So. Yeah, that's true.
We will see.
Summoner Showdown. Now, it's always very interesting to have a look at the leaderboard. Now, I usually keep up to date with the leaderboard. I actually didn't on Friday with the news show, which I normally do. Have you been seeing anything that's excited you about the Showdown itself?
Well, nobody's posting videos on it. From
I know.
What I
it's a very surprising time, because with Act 7.3, when the beta went out, not many people covered the content. I think we kind of like said about that. There's not been like a huge amount of coverage. But I think this is the problem with the summertime and kind of going, right, well, people take it easy. I was thinking about taking it easy, especially as it's going into stuff. But I've got a lot of commitments to things, and also I want to kind of be more. I want to go back. I want to do the grind guides, but also I do want to, in the next couple of months, go back and have a look at some older guides and refresh them. But yeah, it's just it's good to see that there's some good people up there that are grinding this. But some people that I saw last year aren't there. I actually think Sorcerer Supreme of Anto 2 was there last year.
Mm. Yeah, I mean, it's interesting, because we saw Human Torch at the top of the leaderboard early on, and yeah. now it's swinging towards Hercules,
yeah,
which was the worry I know that a lot of people had, that a newly released champion that's very hard to acquire turned out to be the answer for this week, which is what it looks like it is. We're not seeing a lot of videos on it, which I think hurts the overall hype. And I understand why people are playing it close to the vest. They don't want to post a video of how you do a really great run so that everyone they're competing against can copy them.
Yeah, that's true.
They don't want to give everyone the answers to the test. But community buzz is based on us sharing videos. Mm. And right now the event's not set up in a way that really allows the competitors to share the videos while the competition is going on. I mean, normally when we have content, the first 24 hours, it's like, oh, new Summer of Pain fight. I know I'm going to have five Summer of Pain fight videos to share, in the news the next day or something like that. And that's what people are going to be talking about. But there's not a lot to talk about besides the leaderboard, because that's all we've got. And the leaderboard makes people cranky because of Hercules.
Yeah, no, that's the thing. I've just brought up in the America sections that the first three is taken up by Hercules. Europe and Russia.
Ooh, there's a Tigra in Europe.
Yeah, that's pretty impressive.
That's
I'm glad
cool.
to see that. Because that was my joke I did my show on Wednesday, was like, I'm expecting to see lots of different champions, various ones being used to take down, a real smorgasbord of champions. And then it's, I
like that someone's making some Star-Lord runs in Asia and Oceania. That warms my heart.
Yeah.
But yeah, how about that? Apparently there is a really good Tigra player in Europe and Russia.
Yeah, FinTech there.
That is pretty impressive. But the DPS on Hercules is ridiculous.
It is something else. And I think this is the problem, not problem with it. Mastery setup is going to be essential for this, and it is like the quintessential go-to champion to go, right, if you've got Suicide Masteries on, you're able to rotate around, not so much problems with your the potency of those liquid courage and double edge, and still managing to just throw out just some amazing stuff. You get those feats up and you're smashing through some damage. I mean, look, 12k DPS is just unreal. And that's going to be, I want to say, flawless run, full mastery set to offensive. Yeah, that's nice.
I mean, we've talked about how, obviously you got to have the skill. Like, all these players getting on the leaderboard are super amazing players. I think people underrate the skill because they talk about the RNG aspect of it, or you have to get the champ, you have to have the masteries, mm-hmm. you have to get the right AI. All of which is true, but Rich, you and I have both been to Comic-Con and tried to get on the leaderboard, and it is really, really hard.
Yeah,
because all those players are really good. But when you talk about threading the needle, the person in Europe and Russia that's number two with Proxima Midnight.
Yeah.
Can you imagine hitting all those prompts so perfectly?
God, yeah.
Like you want to talk about degree of difficulty.
Yeah.
That is one of the more impressive things. Oh, there's approximate number three in Asia too. Well, that,
yeah.
I mean, just major credit for that, because
yeah.
I mean, we know she's capable of it, but man, to get that to line up for you, that I would like to see that.
Yeah, yeah. I'd like to see that footage as well.
I hope that's recorded, because that I would want
to
see.
So shout out to teacher of AGT. Because that is impressive, especially because there's not much of a time difference between there's 20 second difference between one and third place, and even like what's that, 7 seconds between second and it's kind of annoying really reading this, because there's 7 seconds different. Hang on, is that right? Only because 7 seconds difference in second and third position, and just under 200 DPS difference there, which kind of like is so unfair, because you just think, oh god damn, 7 seconds quicker, and it would have like taken over that Hercules with that Proxima. That's so annoying. Okay, so Summoner Showdown, when we've seen it before, it's been content creators or people of the community. Sorry, I shouldn't say content creators, but it's people of the community who were able to compete against one another, and they had limited mastery. I believe it was 4 stars back then. And are we at a point of going, this is this, I personally feel I don't like the way this Summoner Showdown is put together, especially for the last 2 years. And I know that Kabam, again, have this kind of difficulty about trying to emulate the same thing on a level playing field as they did for the previous Summoner Showdown, so 2019 Summoner Showdown. Is this a good way of delivering this type of competitive event?
I mean, probably not. I mean, understanding the limitations, I know there's been a lot of talk of like, oh, just put everything on the beta server. Like, I don't think that at scale would work.
Yeah.
But I would like to see something like that where you could put it on the beta server and get it a limited amount of people. Like, yeah, maybe there's some sort of qualifier that's on everyone's main account, and then top 20, top 50 or something like that get to go to the beta server, and everyone's got the same mastery limitations and the same champs and even playing field. Like, that to me would be very interesting.
That I agree with. And even though that kind of like undermines the premise of going, first of all, oh right, so if you've got suicide masteries or whatever, the great thing about this is it means that it shakes up who is likely to kind of like to win overall, because then it's all about switching how you're understanding your mastery. So like going, okay, right, so in currently Asia, Oceania, Europe and America, it's everyone's using suicide masteries, let's just say theorize, and then they get through, then they've got to have a limit to then a certain mastery that maybe they're not, number one, accustomed to, or number two, will showcase whether or not they can adapt. Because that's the other thing, adapting and showcasing the best of the best. So that would then shake things up, and the people that you go, oh, this person's definitely going to win it, or this person's definitely is going to do well, it's like, well, maybe they don't. So again, it shakes it up, and is that's what I like, is a nice shake up. It makes it fun. It makes it fresh and different. So yeah, I'm all about that. I think that's a really good idea.
Yeah, so. I mean, that's the fun part about the competition in New York is, well, part of it's that we all see each other, we're watching each other play, and you get to talk to everyone, but it's, you go in and it's just like, okay, like, yeah, I need to get the right AI or whatever, but we're all picking from the same pool of champs, so it's like, all right, well, what's my idea of how this is going to work, what's your idea of how this is going to work,
absolutely.
You know, and it's the, you know, the masteries, the champ acquisition pieces taken out of it, and I think that feels a lot better.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know if they planned. Would they keep it the same? Because last time when we went to the when it was the finals, not New York Comic Con, but the finals of last year, it was this kind of like I'm just trying to like describe what it was. It's not to, for me. I don't find it very exciting. It's the where you pick and then you have.
The ban phase,
I'm not a massive fan of that. I kind of feel it's a little bit boring because it kind of then goes into it turns into Alliance Wars. It's not really something I enjoy like watching because a lot of it's like it plays like chess. It's like what you've done is you've turned a fighting game into chess, and then it's just reduces down the tempo of it, especially from a watching perspective. That's how I felt while I was watching it last year. But I don't know if Caban planned to like change it in any kind of way to like be more exciting. But I mean, I don't know when the finals are going to be. I suspect it will probably fall in line with September, October time, maybe like New York Comic Con stuff. But yeah, is that anything more to talk about with the game?
I don't think so. I mean, you know, I think next week's going to be the big week for the game with the next month's release notes. I mean, we got the Miles and Gamora buffs as well.
Yeah.
At least the spotlights. But you know, until you get to play them, you can't. I know the Gamora buff is not being well received, but I want to play the champs before I make a decision on whether I like it or not.
Yeah, I thought that as well. I read the Gamora buff and I was going, what? Well, that potentially changed? I was kind of like, I'll have to play the champion first to kind of go, like, does it feel different? And I think that's something I will do. I will record some footage of the champion before with numbers and then after and kind of do maybe a comparison video because I'm looking at going like, Is that?
Yeah.
Is that above?
I used to play so much Gamora back in the day. My 3-star Gamora carried me far.
Oh, yeah.
Back in the Act 3 days. Those were the good old days, Rich.
They were the good old days. Right, yep. Let's move on and talk about What If Episode 2. This is probably the most craziest episode ever.
Yeah, see, this was fun and very different than Week 1 What If. Because Week 1 What If is, I would say, a very logical what if, right? Like,
you know,
what if it was Peggy instead of Steve? Like, they were in the same room at the same time, you know, it's like, it's not a stretch.
Yeah,
right?
Absolutely.
Like, you know, T'Challa becoming Star-Lord is, like, way out of left field.
Yeah.
So, like, they went crazy with this, but it was a lot of fun.
We also had this thing we talked about last week. We said about the... There's a lot of micro what ifs in the running of this what if, even stuff that we kind of go like, yeah, but that should that what if have been explained? And like, I don't know what I was like, you what? When it was like, hey, that's genocide. Oh, that's Thanos.
That's right.
That's Thanos.
Yep, Thanos. T'Challa apparently solves all the universe's problems in this episode, except he forgot about Ego. Like,
yes.
He literally saved the whole universe, except they forgot about the original reason that Yondu went to Earth.
Yeah.
And they just left Peter Quill there. But yeah, it's apparently you put T'Challa in space and he just fixes everything. So, you know, the heroes send off for Chadwick. It was... You know, I mean, I don't think you can do this episode if he wasn't voicing, you know, Black Panther in this episode. I don't think it would have worked. I don't think the fans would have wanted it. But it was great to, you know, get, you know, his last performance as T'Challa. And it was a super fun episode. But yeah, we get this reformed Thanos that T'Challa has talked out of his mission. We get Thanos throwing down with the Black Order.
Yeah.
Like, that was, Cull Obsidian bringing the heavy hits.
Yeah, absolutely.
Like, just like in MCOC. And, you know, a lot of what ifs, like you were saying, particularly in the Collector's Vault.
Yes.
Right? Like, I mean, we talked about last week, right? Like, because we were talking about the voice cast and, like, you know, Seth Green being Howard the Duck. And, like, Seth gets more of a speaking part in What If than he did in either Guardians movie.
Yeah.
As Howard. And so we had Howard. Collector apparently is taking out everyone. He has Captain America's shield. He has Hela's crown.
Yeah.
He's been a busy boy, but Carina gets her revenge.
Yeah, it was nice to see her get a bit more time. I think a lot of characters have been given a bit more time. I mean, is it Korag the Pursuer? I can't remember his proper name.
Yes, he got. I mean, that was just a funny seat, right? Because they totally flipped the original Guardians, like Star-Lord who to Star-Lord fanboy.
Yeah, it's like, oh, I know him. Yeah, exactly.
I know you. This is a great honor. Yeah. Like, I shouldn't shoot you. No, you can. You can. It'll be fine.
Yeah,
like there was just a lot of humor to mm-hmm. to him just sort of geeking out on meeting Star-Lord.
Yeah, because you expect in that moment like who, but it, and it's like yeah. It's like, oh, I know you, and it's like yes. Yeah. There's also taser faces in it.
Taser face is showing up.
Kraglin yep. as well. Mm-hmm. So that's good to have that. I kind of felt Michael Rooker's was a bit his voice was a bit soft. It wasn't as kind of raspy as normally with Yondu. But you know, sometimes that can be I don't know down to certain reasons. But yeah, it was a lot of fun. It's a lot of time I'm looking at Thanos each time. I'm going like, what?
It's hard to trust him as reformed, isn't
exactly,
it?
Exactly. I mean, like,
you can't. You can't trust the guy in any universe.
No, exactly. It's good to see that. I think it's T'Chaka, isn't it? T'Chaka's the dad. Yes. He's alive.
Right. Yeah. Yep. So he's alive in this universe.
Shuri doesn't say anything. Actually, I don't think she might say something, but I don't think she's. I'm pretty certain she didn't say a word. She's just there as a kind of a. I don't know, just a character. Who else was in it? I'm just trying to think of some other characters may have kind of like had a sneaky part in it. I don't know if they're...
Well, they had a that Cosmo the dog.
Yeah,
Russian cosmonaut dog. So he actually plays a big role in the Star-Lord and Guardians of the Galaxy comic series because he's this like psychic dog. That helps them out in nowhere and it like kind of runs security for the space station. So that's a little Easter egg from the comics in there as well that they rescue him from the collector.
Yep. God damn it. Drax's family was saved.
Yes. Drax's family was saved. That was just a perfectly written Drax.
Yeah.
Little piece there at the bar. It's like, no, you look terrible. I look amazing. So yeah, the whole thing. I think it was, you know, when they get a little crazy with these, I think they're more fun, and you see things that are familiar, turned on its head.
Yeah.
So, but I honestly hope they follow up on this Peter Quill ego thing, because
that's
a heck of a tease at the end. You know, and it's like, did you get them for just like one line?
Yeah, I kind of feel that's got to lead into more, and whether they'll do like a What If series 2, because then I guess in this circumstance, it may be a case like, what if? You just don't know. What if Star-Lord? I guess it's difficult, really, because he may be. What if Star-Lord actually accompanied Ego on his journey to change the universe? Or maybe what if Peter Quill's like, well, we don't know if like Peter Quill's like mum is kind of living, but I guess it would be a case of like, what if Peter Quill decided to go with Ego? Those are going to be like the things kind of like go with. I didn't see if there was a post-credit scene. I don't know.
I didn't see one. I scanned real quick to see if there was one, but I didn't see any. But I think these are a lot of fun. I think I definitely thought episode 2 was a lot more fun than I liked episode 1. I think episode 2 was just a little bit more wild with the concept, and I think that's where you have to go.
I think it had a purpose to it. Not to say that the episode one didn't have a purpose,
sure,
because obviously the purpose was for them to stop Hydra, stop Red Skull from kind of like using the Tesseract, but it didn't. But that led on to something else. Whereas this one was kind of a closed book story, which was, you know, he was taken when he was a child because he wanted to explore the world. And then it was a case like he was taken into the galaxy for 20 years and then returned back. He then found out that his family had sent, Wakanda had sent some kind of robotic Wakandan spaceship to try and find.
Yeah.
T'Challa, and then he then said, right, okay, I've got to go back to Earth, and the father was still alive, and it was nice because then he had that nice kind of ending point in Wakanda. So I think it just had a nice story, and as well it was nice to see or hear Chadwick for one last time.
It was great to hear him again, so, and just kind of a you know, a triumphant story where he's the star, and he gets to save the galaxy. I think that was a nice thing.
Yeah, absolutely. Right, let's move on and talk a little bit about the Eternals trailer,
because we know a little bit about what's going on.
I felt this was this was the best trailer. I think it's like a year in the making to kind of deliver this, because it gives clarity of what's going on.
And these are characters that I think most people need some clarity on. Mm. Like, we've been joking about this, but the new Spider-Man movie does not need a trailer.
No.
Like, we could say Spider-Man in theaters tomorrow, and we'd be like, all right, well, here's the money.
Yeah.
Here's all the money. It's Spider-Man. We know what it's about. Don't worry about it. But the Eternals, these are not characters, unless, you know, obviously if you're deep into the comic series, you know who they are, but these aren't the brand name recognizable characters. There's a lot of them. People don't know who they are generally, and we don't know about their purpose yet.
Yeah. So
this was important.
Yeah, I think more so because we haven't really got like an origin story and what the bloody hell they were up to whilst Thanos was a thing, because that's the key thing. Why did they not intervene? And they kind of, in that trailer, kind of talked about the idea of their purpose and why they weren't meant to interfere. And I guess we'll find out why more so, why they've been instructed not to interfere, and maybe why they've been, where they got their powers from, those kind of things. Because we see a celestial.
Yeah, a living one.
Yeah.
Yeah, and the Celestials play a huge role in the Eternals' backstory.
So yeah,
I won't give it away, but yeah, they definitely have some cosmic origins. So yeah, we get to see we see Selma Hayek's Ajax. We see a lot of Richard Madden.
Yeah,
as Icarus. We see a little bit of Kit Harington. Now I believe he's playing Black Knight, but I wonder if he's sort of like the human connection to the Eternals.
Yeah,
because I don't think he's actually an Eternal in the comic series. I think he's more got like mystical powers with a special sword.
Because that's what, most of the time I expect him to be in the micro realm. I think he's meant to like occupy something within the micro realm. There's so much to that character. It's one of these situations of going like, was he meant to be associated? What was going on with Thanos? Because some people theorized that he was meant to play a part in it, but they decided to change the story. So whether or not there's a lot of kind of stuff like maybe he was part of something. And it could, you know, you can expect something like, okay, well, when they travel through the micro realm or the quantum realm in order to kind of go through to go back in time, was he going to play some part to go like guide them in a certain way, but wasn't seen in the main movie of Endgame. So all those theorizing things as well could be there. I'm more excited now because there's more of a thing about what they were doing over the years. Because that's the thing I wanted to see. I wanted to see the past. I wanted to see times in Egypt, prehistoric times. And like, if they've lived for 7,000 years, what have they been up to for 7,000 years? What have they sort of but not had any influence in? So, yeah, I'm well up for
this. Yeah, we got some deviants. So we know, they did go and add in their enemies there. So yeah, it's interesting. I'm wondering, we don't really see much of Cersei, who's probably one of the more popular Eternals because she was in the Avengers. But yeah, there's a lot of character names for people to learn.
Yeah.
In this movie, it's a big team, so yeah. I'm wondering how they're going to juggle all that. That's, I would say, that's the biggest challenge of this movie. Where, you could say like, oh, Guardians, like they were kind of unknown, but it's like, all right, well, there's only five of them, and they all look very different.
Yeah. That's
like
true.
One's a raccoon.
Yeah.
One's a an alien pro wrestler.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a little bit easier. To, it's like, all right, now we've got like, the two guys from Game of Thrones, like,
yeah,
like, okay, how do we tell? Well, apparently one has laser eyes, one doesn't. That's how we tell them apart.
Yeah.
I'm interested to see how they handle that.
Yeah, there's a lot of things to look forward to. November 5th, I want to say on this
November
one.
November 5th, yeah, and let's knock on wood, let's hope no more release dates get moved.
Yeah, especially because... So. I think from a conversation on another podcast, it was a case that we'll see something with MCOC as well. So it's nice to kind of feel that we're going to go round circle with this and get something for MCOC. So that's
positive. I'm hoping we get maybe Cersei and Black Knight, or maybe the villain. I don't know who the villain is, but I don't know if they'd put in just like standard deviant. I don't know if there's enough there for that, but I would like to see a couple of Eternals tie-ins, because the movie months are usually pretty awesome.
Yeah. Right, let's talk about some other games just quickly. So, as a lot of you know, or maybe some of you don't know, Marvel Future Revolution is going to launch in next week. So it's the Wednesday the 25th is the global launch. And it's pretty exciting. There's a list of global servers. I think mine, I need to figure out where I am, because this is the thing. I don't actually see my... I just think that. I don't know if I see my... okay, so there's different... It's very hard to explain some of the various different channels and things. I'm a mega flight, so I put myself into... I'm in America server at the moment. I think that's where I am. And then all the other servers for the various different types of server groupings are elsewhere. So it's all pretty crazy. I'm really looking forward to this going live. I'm still trying to get content ready for it, but I'm doing some grinding of alt characters to kind of get ready. How are you feeling about this, Dan? Marvel Future Revolution?
It's funny. I feel like this launch date snuck up on me.
Mm.
Like I kind of can't believe it's here already. Like,
yeah.
With some of these games, we've been in beta for so long, or we've just rumors for so long, and once they started getting this game out there, everything escalated very quickly. So yeah. I'm looking forward to checking it out and getting in there and. I think we've heard a lot of good things about the game from people that have already played it. So, I can't wait to see for myself.
Yeah, I'm just trying to get my content ready for the second channel, which is just because I've been focusing much more on my MCOC stuff and trying to get, because this month has had a lot of kind of grindy stuff. And also I've been really, really busy as we kind of like get ready for the wedding. So it's just trying to like balance in my time. But I'm looking forward to putting content out for it. But I think that's the thing. Next week, maybe we'll have a bit more of a discussion, but it'll be a very busy podcast.
Yeah, next week we'll have release notes, MCOC. Yeah. We'll have, there's going to be some, a new update for Realm. So there'll be some info there that's been released. There'll be Future Revolution. We'll have another What If. Maybe a Spider-Man trailer.
Yeah, that's true.
We'll see. So we will be chock full of content on next week's episode. So
what's
very exciting
with Marvel Realm? How's that going?
I mean, it's a very quiet week. This week, we're expecting some update news later today. Mm-hmm. But I don't really have a preview of it, so there's nothing,
gotcha.
Nothing that we could really talk about there. I think we're going to have to hold that off till next week.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, they've got another update coming soon. It's been pretty quiet though for the last week or so with Realm.
Yeah, I think I will be I think I've said it before. I'd be interested to come back once it's got Wolverine and see how they kind of like go with that one possibly. it's just one of these things where future evolutions just come by, and it's just kind of like time, really. And MCOC as well. It's just nice to try. It's just all about trying to find a balance with games.
And sure.
Kind of like thinking, yeah. I'm thinking about posting as well, because that's the other thing as well. Like I do want to. I'd love to post some Marvel Realm of Champions content, but it's just finding the time at the moment. And when I get my weekends back, which I currently do not have my weekends anymore.
Not yet, Rich.
We'll do in October, but then I've got plans to do more of updating on my old guides. And now with all these buff champions in MCOC, we kind of like have to, you know, focus on trying to get up-to-date content. That's the biggest. Oh, up-to-date champions with the older content, those kind of things. Bit of a tough one.
Yeah, no, there's the to-do list never gets any shorter.
Oh, God, yeah. Right, I think that's been a good little show. We've covered a lot of stuff with all games, trailers, new films and stuff, which is nice. That's what we like to do on the podcast now, is kind of talk about games, also talk about movies, you know, a little bit of everything for people. Dan, what are you up to next week? What are you trying to get done next week?
Well, I'm going to try to get done the Summer of Pain final challenge. That is going to occupy most of my weekend. We'll see how far I get. It's really going to depend on how quickly I can get good at the Grandmaster.
Yeah.
So what did MSD had some helpful tips. About,
I'll have to check that out, I think.
Yeah, just being really good at the game and you know, having She-Hulk.
Yeah, that's good.
No, I tease, obviously. He's actually, you know, he's put out a ton of Grandmaster content, and it's very helpful. But you know, my skill level is nowhere close to his.
Yeah, same with me, you know, just about trying to like get some enjoyment really with it as much as possible. But yeah, I'm looking forward to seeing that. I'm going to watch some of his videos, I think. Right, that has been the podcast. Thanks, everybody, for listening and paying attention. As all you know, YouTube, SoundCloud, Spotify, and iTunes podcasts, we're all available on all the different podcasts. And we'll see you next time for another deep dive. Bye-bye for now.